Thank you. congregation at this time to stand and face the processional cross. We make way forward, singing, O come, all ye faithful. Have seen a great light.
On those who live in the land, the shadow of death, a light has dawned.
For to us a child is born, To us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders.
And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Let us pray. Mighty God, Everlasting Father, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that as we've been knowing the mysteries of that light on earth, we may also come to the fullness of his joys in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for a rendition of our choir. Christmas Eve is from Isaiah chapter 7. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz. Ask a sign of the Lord your God, that it be deep as Sheol or high as the heavens. But Ahaz said, I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test. And he said, Hear then, O Israel, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men? As you must also weary my God. Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Epistle from 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, let us love one another. For love is from God. And everyone loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world, so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also should love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. We have seen, testify, the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. So, we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in Eden.
Praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest heaven,
and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about.
Yeah.
Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. For he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but he knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Come to judge the living and the dead.
I'm Isaiah, the mighty prophet, they call me. I lived in between 780 BC to 700 BC. I served four kings in my prophetic office. Those four kings were Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Manasseh. My call is recorded in Isaiah chapter 6, where God approached me, opened my eyes to see his glory, moved me to such shame and guilt because it revealed my sin. And I said, woe is me, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among unclean people. The Lord then had an angel take a tongue and a burning coal from the altar, tish my tongue, and said, be clean. That experience then moved me to proclaim the prophetic word of God to those four kings over the course of my life. I lived in a time where kings looked to their gods for prosperity, for protection, for victory in battle. During the first king I served, Uzziah, he had expanded the kingdom. It was a prosperous era. He was restoring the Davidic kingdom from his grandfather's names. But you know what happens when kings have a lot of prosperity in their country and they think that everything is going well because of them. They get a little arrogant. Uzziah lived in a time in which the king was not only a mighty ruler and warrior of the people, but the other countries understood the king to be the high priest of the religion. This is where Uzziah's downfall took place. One day he was going to make himself the Messiah, and he was going to say, I'm just not the king, but I'm the high priest. And he went into the temple, and went to offer the burnt incense, which only the priests are allowed to do. 80 priests confronted Uzziah and said, don't do it. But he would not listen to their counsel. He sacrificed that incense anyway. Because he was not obedient to the will of God, God struck him with leprosy. And he lived as an isolated king for the rest. His son Jotham became king next. He was a good king. Era of prosperity also continued underneath him. But his reign was kind of short. Some say that people in the country sought to get rid of him because he was against this country called Assyria, a rising power in the north, a mighty power in the north. Everyone was scared of Assyria, not just Israel, but all the surrounding countries of the world. They were the big dog. So Jotham, who wished to fight against Assyria, had a movement go against him within his own country. As they began to look at the power of Assyria, the power of Judah, and they forgot about the Almighty God. They just forgot. So they said to Jotham, we need to be more in favor of the Assyrians. We need to let them be the ruler of the world. We need to give them our lunch money and pay them tribute. Jotham would have none of that. Therefore, people of Israel got fed up with him and sought to depose him quickly and to make Ahaz the king in place. Ahaz was pro-Assyrian. He liked the Assyrians, and he knew their history, that they could be bought off. That if you wish to get along with the Assyrians, just send them your money. Fighting them was useless. Tonight, you heard a context of a conversation I had with King Ahaz from Isaiah chapter 7. Let me give you a little more background on what's going on here. There were two countries that were aligning themselves against Assyria, thinking that if we could just get Ahaz's country with us, the country of Judah, if we can get three countries united, we can defeat Assyria. But again, Ahaz was pro-Assyrian. He always thought that if you fought Assyria, you're going to lose. So he was not going to go in with this plan. So the two kings said, if he's not going to go in with this plan, then we will go in and defeat his country. Our two nations will overcome the people of Judah, and we will put a king in Ahaz's place, the son of Tabal, son of Taylor. Translated in English, the God of the good God, the son of the good God. Because the people in the north that have understood what was going on with Ahaz, they had this thing in the south of Judah called the Davidic dynasty. And there was this promise God had given to the people of Judah that there would always be someone from David's family that would rule on the throne. Never would anybody be taken off of that throne. So Ahaz is kind of banking on that promise. And he's coming up with another plan, thinking that I can buy off Assyria and keep the Davidic line going. So the people of these two kingdoms, Syria and Israel, which is the north part of that kingdom, because now for 200 years, the country of Israel was divided into the north and south. They had their own civil wars. And they thought that if we can depose Ahaz, we can get Judah in with us, and we'll have a mighty force against the Assyrians. And so these two countries, Syria and Israel, are besieging our city of Jerusalem and the country of Judah. And Ahaz is getting scared. Now, why would he be so scared of these two countries? Because they had routed us before some years ago. They had routed us so bad that they took some of our people, some of our citizens of the city of Jerusalem as hostages. We're going to make them slaves. But God sent a prophet named Obed to tell the people of Israel, send your brothers back home. So that's the history. So when you look at Isaiah chapter 7, God tells me to go and visit Ahaz and to settle him down. Tell him to calm down. Don't let these two kings get to him. For I am with this country. I have a promise to fulfill. Ahaz just needs to settle down. But Ahaz didn't get it. He thought God had forsaken him. God had forsaken Judah. Where was God when these two countries defeated them some years ago? So Ahaz was really done with God, the God of Abraham. He was done. He had not delivered Ahaz and Judah from these two kings before. Why would he do it now? So, I kind of understand Ahaz. I understand his nerves, his fears, because of the history. But God told me to go and have Ahaz buckle up, quit licking your wounds, man up, trust in me. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I will do this for you. So I went to Ahaz. He was a nervous man, thinking that he had the better plan of buying off Assyria than trusting in God. And I said to him, those words which you heard tonight, ask the sign of the Lord. Make it as deep as hell or Sheol, or make it as high as the heavens. opinion has for whatever reason says, I will not ask, I will not put the Lord to the test. Maybe it was because he'd given up on God already because of the last defeat he had with these two countries. Or maybe he was trying to become self-righteous before me and all of a sudden put on this good show. Not really sure. But he would not ask for a sign, even though God told him to ask for one. Go figure. And so I said, do you weary men so much that you must also weary my God also, house of David? Behold, the Lord will give you a sign, a virgin shall conceive and bear forth a son. You shall call his name Emmanuel. Translated into English, is God with us? That was the issue Asaph had. He didn't think God was with us. We got beat by these countries last time. Where was he then? And now, Isaiah, you telling me that God is with us? Go take your prophecy and leave. I will have none of the prophecy had two fulfillments. One, among the harem of Ahaz, there was a virgin. And she did conceive and bear a son. His name was called Hezekiah. And it was prophesied about Hezekiah in Isaiah chapter 7 that when he knew to reject evil and choose right, he would then eat a diet of curds and honey. Legend says Hezekiah, was a man that really stayed to the vegetables. And it even caused some concern for his citizens to wonder not whether or not he could be a good king if he stayed on such a diet. But then I went on to tell Ahaz that before this young man born is going to be able to reject evil and choose right, the two lands of the kings of which you dread shall be laid to waste. And they were. But because Ahab was trusting Assyria, Assyria eventually came back and put the screws on top of Ahab, so to speak. He had to pay so much money to Assyria to keep them from besieging the city, from destroying the city, that he even took the temple grounds and the temple treasuries and gave them to Assyria to say, leave us alone. And he began therefore to shut down the whole worship of Yahweh in his country. Maybe because he didn't want people to see what he had done to the temple. Instead, he introduced more idolatry. More idolatry. But Ahaz eventually dies. King Hezekiah comes into play. And here comes the God. Here was the God that understood Emmanuel. For the Assyrian army had besieged Judah. And Hezekiah received this letter from Sennacherib, the king of the Assyrian army, and said, look, you come out willingly, and we're going to come in and destroy you all. How can your God save you? So he took that letter, presented it to the God of Yahweh, and said, Lord, this is in your hands. No heaven. Emmanuel. God being miraculous deliverance. That night, he sent an angel, and that angel slew 185,000 Assyrian soldiers in the middle of the night. And Assyria was defeated by one angel. Hezekiah knew something his dad didn't. Trust in Yahweh. Trust in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He will be with us, and he will deliver us miraculously. Tonight, you are here as Christians because you're celebrating really now the second fulfillment of the prophecy. During the time of Hezekiah, how things were going so good under his reign, people were saying, Emmanuel, not necessarily calling him Emmanuel, but he was being a king at a time where they believed God was with us again. Because he was delivering them miraculously from physical torments. Tonight, you celebrate that second fulfillment, where a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, shall call his name Emmanuel. Again, we don't call Jesus Christ Emmanuel, we call him Jesus Christ. But during his reign, during his time, and now as he reigns on this earth, we are living in a time of Emmanuel. God is with us. During this time as Christians, we are not only celebrating the fact that this Emmanuel has come to deliver us from physical oppression, but he's come to deliver us from something greater, spiritual oppression. There on the cross of Calvary, do you not see the miraculous hand of God delivering you? Can you not see it? God, in his mighty power, has his arms stretched out on the cross to deliver you from the spiritual oppression of sin and death and darkness. Amen. God with us, and not just in this world, forever, eternity, because of the miraculous delivery on that cross of Calvary some years ago. Today, signs are still before us. You will not have a prophet come before you and say, ask a sign from the Lord. Ask, may it be as low as Sheol or high as the heavens. You will not need to ask because the signs are now given to you. They are called his word, his sacraments, and infant baptism, and the Lord's Supper. These are signs that God is with us. We don't need to ask for them. We just simply use them. And as we use these signs God has given to us, his people, we are assured. Emmanuel! God is with us to deliver us not only from physical, but more important, spiritual oppression through his son Jesus. In his name, amen. dwelling with us, becoming one of us, but not yet losing your divinity, so that through the power of your divinity, you bring salvation to humankind. We thank you for this great gift of Jesus and the gift of life he brings. We ask you now, Lord, to bless these gifts in response to what you bestowed upon us, so that others may now hear the good news of the birth of Christ and the purpose of his visitation, so they too may turn and believe with us and recognize that in their life, despite all darkness and oppressive powers, Emmanuel, you're with us to deliver us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. This time we ask you to stand as we now pray and bring our prayers forward. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this day we celebrate the gift of life, born in Bethlehem to be our Savior. Since as his redeemed children we have the command and invitation to do so, let's now bring our prayers and our petition before the throne of grace. Father, Lord, we again give you thanks for the sending of your Son, Jesus Christ, into this world. We ask, O Lord, that you would continue to help us trust in your promises, and trust, O Lord, in your hand for deliverance. Praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest.
We ask you, O Lord, to be with all of our rulers in this land and in the world. Many of them may not confess themselves to be Christ's followers, but that does not matter. For you, O Lord, have all things in control. Emmanuel, you are with us. Guide and direct these rulers, O Lord, in accordance with your holy will, so that your people may have their daily needs met. Glory and praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest.
Father, we think of all those who are sick and ill and lonely this evening and cannot be with us because of these conditions. May, O Lord, take a moment to remember them in our hearts and minds. Father, strengthen us in our outreach and ministry to them. Though we may not be able necessarily to heal them from all physical wounds and illnesses, but you, O Lord, can, and you can send us to bring them comfort and help them in their struggles. Glorifying, praising God and saying,
Lord, God Almighty.
Receive our prayers and our praise, Lord God Almighty, for you live and reign forever, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, tonight we celebrate your birth. We pray the prayer you taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Point of our service, we light the candles. Please make sure that the lit candle stays steady. Do not tip that one, but tip the only one to the lit candle.
Thank you.
Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you, look upon you with his favor, and give you his peace.
Amen.
You may extinguish your candle.